We are talking to David Lee, who is from Singapore, and he is consultant for our child care and education project. Hi, David. Hello.
Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Fine, thank you.
Actually, how did you first involved with our credit union?
I'm a member of the Wise Men International, and I remember vividly 1 year ago, the Wise Men International Smith District had a conference here in Dhaka, and we part of the program was to come and visit this well-known Dhaka Credit Union. The district governor then of the Smith District is Mr. Babu Marcus Gomez, who is also the president of the Dhaka Credit Union. So I remember 1 year ago, in 2015, we paid a visit to this place. And that was when we were first introduced to the objects of the credit union and the work that it's been doing. That was how I got first to know about the Dhaka Credit Union.
You saw Dhaka Credit Union activities, you saw our research center, you saw our credit union school program, you saw our cooperative shops, you saw our activities in the branch offices, and you saw our activities in the headquarters here in Dhaka Credit. So after having seen all these things, activities, what is your observation about our activities?
I think the Dhaka Credit Union is a very progressive organization. Although I've been around many parts of the world and seen many different other organizations, I must say that the Dhaka Credit Union is extremely ambitious and very caring for the welfare of its members. This is seen from the many activities that I can see that the credit union is trying to do, from the areas of finance, lending up money to the members at very reasonable interest rates, collecting deposits for those who have spare cash, to even having a school and a resource center and a resort. And I understand that in the days to come, there will even be a hospital or a training institution for doctors. And right now, very soon, you're going to have your first childcare center in Dhaka. And I must say that a lot of effort is put in because the scope is so wide. And yet, the credit union has been able to master the support of the members and also to attract the right professionals to join the organization to make all this a possibility.
How actually you are running your own childcare centers, education centers in Singapore, and as we know, you have experience about 20 years about childcare and child education. So how you can help promote our childcare and education center in Dhaka?
I'm happy that with my experience in Singapore's context, which is a slightly different society, is applicable here. Firstly, because parents are the same everywhere. All parents love their children and want to have the best for their children. In Singapore, we're the same situation, except perhaps we are more fortunate in Singapore because we have some quite a bit of government support for childcare centers. Well, over here, with the pricing that you are putting out, I can say that you, in your own way, the credit union is also providing the kind of support for the parents who enroll in a center. And this would help parents to have that peace of mind when the mummies go to work, that they know that they're leaving their children in very safe hands with the staff. You've also spent a lot of money, made a lot of detailed planning to make sure that the facility will be one that's extremely secure and one that's extremely safe for the children. I think in Dhaka's context, this is very important because all parents want to make sure that the place is safe and secure, and that when they go to work, they can work with peace of mind. And besides having safe and secure facilities, I'm also happy to be involved in the training of the staff. In fact, some of the staff were seconded to Singapore and attached to my centers. And from there, I can see that they have basically, number one, the good basic education, and number two, the willingness to learn, and thirdly, they have the love for children. Now, it is very important in a childcare center setup that the staff are trained and the staff love children. If they are trained but they don't love children, it's going to be difficult. And if they love children but they are not trained, they don't know what to do, you know, and how to develop the child, that's another kind of problem. So I'm happy to note that in your DC childcare and education center that you're going to set up soon, it is something that comes with the right staff, which is important. It's a software.
DC childcare center is located in the heart of the city, and you are providing consultation for the infrastructure also, and also all the materials, the placings for the children and the furniture and all the educational curriculums. Say something about all these particulars.
Right. When the staff went to Singapore, we do not believe in shutting down the throat of the staff, as it were, to say that you must do this, you must do it this way, you must do it that way, in terms of curriculum. Because you understand that the Dhaka population may have slightly different needs and slightly different pace of learning. So what we felt was important was to train the staff who went to Singapore to be able to understand the needs of the children and how to provide for them, and not simply say you must learn by this way, you must learn A, B, C, three letters. No choice, you must learn it. We don't force it down upon them. So the staff have been trained how to accommodate, how to observe, and how to evaluate the pace of the learning of the children, and to fit it so that the curriculum will be able to meet the needs and the pace that the children are able to learn. Now, this is very important. You can imagine if the children were to be forced to learn, you know, certain things by certain time, they will not find joy in learning. And that is one very important difference in this DC center. Because you want to make learning fun, we want to make learning a joy, and we want to make even, for example, play to be instructional, to be developmental. We don't just simply give them a toy and, you know, any toy will do. No, we actually select what kind of toy, because this toy we know will perhaps develop the gross motor skill or the fine motor skill of the child. Or this toy, this game that they're going to play will help them in their memory. So every toy that we select for the center, every activity that we plan is with a purpose in mind. And that is important.
Why actually did you choose 18 months to 6 year children in this center?
Right. I suppose this is a kind of model that worldwide it is kind of practiced. Because when a child is below 18, it is more challenging in terms of the developmental age of the child. For example, if the child still has not been properly toilet trained and the staff were to spend a lot of time just changing nappies, you know, that will actually take up a lot of time from other children. Or we will have to end up with staff who are just plain, you know, having got to do a lot of meeting their routine needs, you know, changing the nappy, powdering, you know, bathing them, cleaning them after they have dirtied themselves and things like this. It's important. It's not important. It's important. But we feel that perhaps some of that can be in a center or in a home environment that is specially catered for these needs. In Singapore, for example, I have three out of my seven centers. I have three centers that have got infant care. Infant care in Singapore means taking in children from as young as 2 months old, So that's very young. So I have to have a special group of teachers, a special group of staff. Some of them, one of which usually I would employ a staff nurse from who has a nursing background. Mm-hmm. The rest are teachers who have been trained in looking after children of this age. And they have a special environment, special kind of beds, special kind of cribs, special kind of toys. Even the chairs that they sit on is selected for their age. And believe me, from 2 months to 18 months, you have to have quite different kind of chairs because they grow very fast during that stage. So we have a special section, especially catering for that. Now, because this is a new center in DC, childcare, I have advice, perhaps don't be so ambitious. We start from 18 months, because by 18 months, most of the children will be toilet trained. You know, they'll be able to walk, they'll be able to take instructions. You know, they'll be able to sit down and listen to instructions. Not that they'll sit down and not move, they will move, they'll run around, but at least they can take simple instructions, and it'll be possible, more possible, to teach them, to educate them, than the much younger children. That's why we have agreed to 18 months to 6 years.
We have 6 teachers here,
yes.
And they are highly educated,
yes.
And 3 of them got training from your center in Singapore. So do you think they can support fully to run this center?
I think for a start, because at this moment we are waiting for the enrollment numbers to come in. We don't know where the numbers are. When I say numbers, I mean where, which class, which level they come in. My suspicion and my experience with setting up centers in Singapore is when it's a new center, less likely for the KG2 children to be enrolled, because they may be in a KG kindergarten somewhere and parents would be reluctant. I think it's not fair for the children. You know, if they've been there for a few years, 2-3 years, and suddenly the parents say, okay, out you come, you go to this good DC center. You know, they may be reluctant. So usually we think that KG2 will not have enrollment. Of course, if there are, we'll be happy to take them. But I think there's less chances. So more chances will be at nursery, playgroup, and maybe maximum KG1. So it's okay. I think the 3 teachers with the principal who is well-trained, I think they should be able to cope.
What difference could be made out of the center? Because the other ordinary schools for the kids in Bangladesh are not like this. So this is something very different.
Yes.
This is, hopefully it will make some difference. And how do you think about it?
Right, I think even as I share and even as I say, your president, you know, convey the concept to the board initially, it was a bit challenging. Because people don't quite understand, what is child care? Do we just look after the children? Or is it a kindergarten that runs for 12 hours? Because the service hours is 12 hours total, from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Okay? So let me try to explain a little bit of how the child care concept is commonly found in many parts of the world. In many parts of the world, the mummies, the ladies, are getting progressively better and better educated. And as they get better educated, after they finish their education, they want to go to the workforce. It's natural. Unless there's some special reasons. Like maybe the family don't want her to go to work or something like that. But otherwise, I think most ladies will go to work. So when they go to work, they'll find enjoyment in work. They'll make a lot of friends. They will be able to socialize, and they're very comfortable. And sometimes as a result of this comfort, they don't get married. That's bad for countries like mine, Singapore. The age of marriage is getting higher and higher. That means ladies are getting married at an older and older age. Nevertheless, they will eventually, hopefully, get married. Yeah. So when they get married, they get married, you start a family soon after. Maybe soon after, maybe sometime after. But when they get pregnant and they have a child, they have new problems because they have to decide whether the mummy is going to leave her job, stay at home, and become a homemaker. Some do so and be a homemaker for a few years, and when the children are a bit older, then they go back to the workforce. But in today's society, it's getting more challenging because the amount of money you make might not be quite enough. I mean, the money that's made by the husband, the father, might not be so enough for the family's expense. And so they have to encourage the mommy, say, maybe mommy consider go back to work too. They say, good, mommy can go back to work, but who's going to look after the baby? So that's the problem of today's society, not just Bangladesh, not just Singapore, all over the world. So what is commonly needed as a solution is therefore a facility whereby parents can leave the child while they go to work and come back after work to fetch their children. So in many cities, of course, this childcare may not be so common in rural areas, yeah, but in cities it's particularly important. I can see that with a very populated city here in Dhaka, I think once our first center gets started, there will be many more coming up because parents will then understand the benefit of sending their children to a facility like a childcare center. So what they do is they go in the morning, send the child to the center, and then the child will be in the center until the mummy comes back from work or the daddy comes back from work and go to the center and fetch the child. So the center opens from 7. Doesn't mean that the parents must go there by 7 because the curriculum time actually starts at about 9. So as soon as parents reach there before, by say 8:45, it's quite safe. And the benefit is that the parents can actually bring the child straight to the center and the center will provide breakfast. So there's no need to say, I feed the child until he's ready, then I bring him. Then by the time I bring him, I will be late for work. So how? So we actually will solve that part of the problem by saying, when you send a child to the center, you don't have to feed the child yet. You know, send the child to the center will provide the meals. So the center, what will the child do during the day? The child, when it's received in the morning, the child will then have breakfast. And after breakfast, there'll be lessons. And after lessons, there'll be a lunch break. There'll be lunch, will be provided in the center, by the center, and then there'll be a shower, right, by the teachers. And after the shower, they will have a rest time. So the proper mattresses for them to sleep on, and they will have a nap in the afternoon. They will get up by about maybe 3 o'clock or so, and they will have a tea break, that means they have another snack, and then the class will continue again. And they will continue until about 6 o'clock. Or 5:30, 6 o'clock. And thereafter, that will be about the time when most parents or many parents will be off from work and can go there and fetch their children. Now there's no necessity to say you must come exactly at 5 o'clock or come exactly at 5:30. As long as you come before 7, we are happy. Okay, so the only one advice that I will give parents is this. If this is the first day you're sending your child to the school, please try to come a bit earlier. Now, why is this my advice? Because children will be going home. And if your child is the last person to go home, and the child will be very anxious, where is my mummy? Where is my daddy? So I'll say, this is the first day, first week, maybe make a little more effort to come a bit earlier so that don't be the last, so that the child will feel comfortable. The child will have confidence that mummy or daddy will come and fetch him or her to go back home. So that would be important.
Actually, what is the speciality of the lesson plan here?
Yeah, so the lesson plan will cover the 6 domains, okay, which includes the language arts, which include discovery of the world. That means that in old school language, it means that you cover English, which is our medium of instruction, okay, simple arithmetic, simple science, simple art and craft, simple numeracy, and also development of the motor skills of the children. So in terms of these areas, the curriculum will cover all these areas and they will be packed to the various groups. That means that while we provide for children from 18 months all the way to 6 years, it doesn't mean that all of them are in one class. They'll be separated into the class that's appropriate for them. So the 5 to 6 years old will be one group, 4 to 5 years old will be one group, and so on and so forth. So it won't be a teacher trying to teach children of different ages, because that would be difficult. Yeah. And besides the English instruction medium, we are here in Bangladesh, obviously they need to speak Bengali. So there will be Bengali teachers who will teach the children Bengali as a language. So only for the Bengali lessons, they will be taught in that language. Okay, but we may try to mix a bit so that it won't be just that lesson. So you're thinking, maybe for art and craft, maybe they also will be taught in Bengali instead of English. Yeah, and maybe for the free play period, they might be actually exposed to the language again. So we don't want the children to be totally alienated. I mean, my son used to say this when he was in childcare. You know, he would go to school and come back and say, why must I, because we are I'm ethnic Chinese. So we teach English, medium instruction, and we also teach Chinese. So he'll say that, I am English boy, why should I learn Chinese? So we also don't want the children here, Bangladeshi children, to say, I'm English boy, I don't want to learn Bengali, you know. So we hope that they will be able to embrace the language of the land. Yes.
How do you visualize the children after 6 years?
I will see that, that's a very good question. I will see that the children who go through the DC childcare, they'll come out, number one, being confident. That means they know that what they're doing is the right thing and this is the right way to do it. For example, in reading, they know that this is how you read and they'll be confident. They won't stammer, they would read confidently. They'll be able to do simple tasks confidently when it comes to academic. At the same time, I envisage that they'll be polite and responsible people. They will learn to greet their seniors. They'll learn to be respectful towards others. It's even in as simple things as how they groom themselves. For example, in our toilets, you know, our toilets, the water closet, the WC, is child size. You'll be surprised to, because you'll be surprised because I was surprised because when I told the architect I want child size, you know, water closet. See, very hard to find, very expensive because they must specially import. I said, but we must. Otherwise, the children have to climb up onto the water closet to use it. And it's dangerous. So we're going to have child-sized water closet. We're going to have child-sized wash basins. And when I told them, you must put a mirror, like in the adult toilets, you put a mirror. But if you go to other centers in Bangladesh, in Dhaka, and see, there's no mirror. I said, it's a waste of money to put a mirror and the children will damage it. But I insisted there's a mirror. So what is the mirror for? The mirror is so that the child can groom himself or herself when she finished bathing or going to the washroom, wash your hand. Make sure you groom yourself properly, then you come out of the washroom. So these are little things that we teach them. So it will become habit, you know. One other interesting thing that I can share is that in terms of feeding, you know, a lot of parents, okay, so of course, sometimes parents are concerned that, oh, my child doesn't like to eat this, she doesn't like to eat that, she doesn't eat this, you know, she takes 1 hour at home for me to feed, because you take one mouthful, then run for, you know, a few rounds, then second mouthful. So I always tell parents, this is one thing for sure, I'll do magic. What magic? I say, I'll do magic, because when they come to the center, we'll train them, so the next thing that I can see after they leave our center is they'll be disciplined children. You'll find that they will sit there at the table, they will eat. Because the answer is very simple, it's actually peer pressure. Because you'll see their friends eating, sitting down to eat, you know, and they will also learn to sit down and eat, and eat by themselves.
All together.
Automatically.
Yeah,
automatically. Of course, by certain age. Not the very young ones, you know. Yeah. By the time they are about 3 or 4, they will start to learn how to feed themselves. So you find that it's very interesting. The children, because it's peer pressure. When I see you eating by yourself, I also want to imitate you. You know, right. I don't want to, you know, right, lose out to you. Right. So they will do it. So one of the things which I say we will be able to do for your child magically is they will be able to sit down, feed themselves, and finish a meal in suitable time. Of course, we don't force them to eat quickly. Yeah. At suitable timing, you know, which is different from they run around the whole house. Yeah. But of course, if they go home and the parents were to allow them to do what they want, then the problem will come back at home. So it's important, even as we do our best to help the child and to develop the child, the parents also do their part. The parents will work with us. So that's why in our center, set up, we have two times a year we'll have a parent-teacher meeting.
Okay.
Yeah. So the parents will come, we'll tell the parents, okay, these are what teachers have observed, and that these are areas your child is doing well, these are areas that maybe your child needs some improvement, and things like this. So there'll be parent-child. Of course, the parents can also share with us, oh, at home my child runs around, all this and that. So we can also share. So it's important that the parent-teachers meeting allow the parents to share the teachers as much as the teachers will share with the parents. Yeah. So the other point, as you have asked, what we can see in the child is that the child will be disciplined. And the next thing, the child will learn to be a creative learner.
Mm-hmm.
What am I creative? Because we do not believe in telling the child, you must. You know, I went to some of the centers, not our center, our center. So we went to some of the existing centers. So the teacher would draw a circle and say, okay, children, all follow me. So everybody will sit down there on the table and a desk and a chair and draw the circle. Say, okay, next we draw this, the eyebrows, then they draw that. So it's everything is almost learning by rote. You know, there's no creativity. So the way that we teach will be totally different.
Okay.
Number one, we are not going to have the desk and chair laid out like in a classroom. Rather, our desk and chairs will arrange so that the children will be always learning with their friends. You know, and when the teacher is telling a story, the children will all be sitting around the teacher so that you'll be very warm and intimate. It won't be something like the teacher delivering a lecture to an adult. So those are some of the very fundamental differences that we believe in and which we will be able to deliver, and we hope that by so delivering this to the children, they will benefit from it and really become responsible, creative, disciplined learners of tomorrow. Because learning is continuous. They don't stop learning because they finish university or they finish high school. They continue to learn, and we must teach them how to learn and not just give them a book and say, okay, you know this book.
Yeah. So what kind of citizen you want to see them, those children coming to the center?
What kind of citizen?
What kind of citizen? They're very ideal citizen, and they will be going outside country, and they will earn a lot, and they will promote the nation.
Yeah, I of course we cannot say that you come to our center and after this we will influence your mind, your thinking, so that you want to be a citizen of country X. No, I don't think that's our intention. But we want the child to learn to be independent and responsible and disciplined and creative, and that he or she will be able to think for himself or herself. She'll be able to explore and learn. If let's say she look at the moon and say, wow, the moon tonight is extra large. Why? You know, they ask the daddy and mommy, the daddy and mommy may not, don't know, maybe, I don't know. So he will be interested to learn from himself. He may be able to go to the internet and find out, oh, because it's super moon. You know, because the moon at that time is very close to the earth. And so therefore the moon appears to be very large. And indeed, the moon is the same size. It's just that the moon and earth are very close to each other. So it appears extra large. And it's a super moon. So he'll be able to share with the parents. Now, as to whether because he saw a super moon, will he want to leave the country and go somewhere else? I don't know. But I think by anchoring him to his country, to your country, Bangladesh, by teaching him Bengali, makes him remember from young that there's still this language, Bengali, and that is his motherland. That is where he comes from. And he should have that love for his country. So we will establish that in the center.
So what is your last time to come to the center? I mean, you will be coming all the time? Because this center will continue. So you'll come time to time to visit?
Yeah.
Or
yes, I answer your question. So actually, I last visited your center yesterday. Okay, but
in the future?
Yeah, that's right. So January you open, on the 15th of January you open. And then I hope to be able to come back, not every month, maybe every few months to be able to see the progress of the first center. And if this center works out well, I would say that we should soon thereafter plan for new centers, because I will see that there will be people who either want to learn from this center, how you do it, why you do this, why you do that, why don't you do this, why don't you do that, why do you get the teachers to, you know, color out and make a Christmas tree, say. Why don't you just go to the shop and buy one Christmas tree and put it there? Why? Because when the children participate and contribute their little part, they hang their little ornament, whatever, and contribute to make a tree, they have a sense of pride, a sense of belonging to a group. You know, my class, this is my class project, this is our Christmas tree. Of course we know you can buy a Christmas tree much more beautiful, much nicer looking, but that's not ours, that money will buy. You know, but we want one that we made from our own labor, and it's our own creativity, you know, and I think that will make the difference in the children. So when we start, I will foresee that very soon, maybe a few months later, we have to start planning for another center and another center and another center. So I think that there is scope.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think that's important.
And I so far I know, all the children from all communities, Christian, Hindus, Muslims, all the children will be here together. How do you see? What is their religion class, or how do you see? How do you educate their religion?
Yeah. Unfortunately, we will not be teaching any specific religious classes. We will not be doing that. Okay. However, we will teach them to respect each other's religion. Okay. Simple things like this. If it's Christmas, everybody would celebrate Christmas. You know, when there's a special Muslim festival, we won't celebrate it. So in so doing, the teachers will take the opportunity. Christmas, we tell them the story, Christmas story. So everybody, whether you are Christian, whether you are Hindu, whether you are Buddhist, you know, everybody will learn what is it about. What is Christmas about? You know, when it comes to the Eid festival, again, we tell everybody the Eid festival, why do they do this? You know, what is the celebration about? How do they celebrate it? You know, what are things they do and what things they don't do? And everybody will learn together. So there won't be classification to say, oh, you are Christian, or you are Buddhist, or you are Muslim. You know, so we won't do it that way. Everybody will learn together.
What kind of measures have you taken for safety and security of the children?
Yeah,
in the center.
Okay, there are various aspects to safety. So in terms of general safety, we have made sure that the floor is not going to be, I mean, a lot of places you see the floor is either just cement screed, or at most they have a tile on the flooring to ensure easier maintenance. But we are doing something different. We are putting a vinyl flooring. The vinyl flooring is made of a material that will not allow children to slip easily. So therefore, by so doing, we are trying our very best to make sure that the child will not slip easily. And even if they were to slip, the material is such that it is padded. That is padded beneath. So that when the child were to fall, the impact will be absorbed by the materials of the floor. Okay. We also look into, for example, the wall. If there's a sharp corner in the wall, we actually will protect it for the children. If there's a door, you know, children tend to put their fingers in between the door and the door frame. We'll protect that so that the children cannot put their fingers. So in terms of those features, we have looked into. Of course, we also, the doors of the centers will be locked. Of course, locked with the people inside able to unlock it in case of emergency. Yeah, so it'll be locked so that strangers will not just come in. They have to press the bell and the staff have to come and attend to the person, to the visitor. And very importantly, for emergencies. Why is there an emergency? You know, many places there's only one door, one exit. You get in, you come out from there. And if there's an emergency, that exit is obstructed. there's nothing much more you can do. Okay, so in our case, we actually have intentionally built an additional fire escape for the children. The center happens to be on the first story and second story, so we built a fire escape specially for them from second story all the way down to the ground. And we have also designated, we also gone around the surrounding to identify where is the place of refuge in case there's an emergency. It could be a fire, it could be earthquake or whatever. So they will get out and the teachers will be all trained. There'll be drills. You know, every 6 months there'll be a drill for them to practice exiting from the center and proceeding in an orderly fashion to the refuge area to wait for further instructions. So we practice this as a drill for the children. So the children will learn this. So as far as that is concerned, we look into all areas of the safety. I mean, in the toilet, for example, the towels will be non-slip towels. So we make great effort to make sure that everything would ensure the best possibility. Even in the playground on the ground floor, you know, we find the right materials and make sure that it will not harm the child in any way. The child will not be exposed to certain risks that is unnecessary.
So David, thank you for your nice talk, sharing, and hope it will give a new hope for the children in Bangladesh.
Yes, I certainly hope so. Thank you very much.
Thank you.